necessary on an existing product line so that they could support this new protocol. So it was a 2-year initiative. So I just want to talk about a few things that basic to this particular product. So first is, because of the complexity of the app, it was not possible to do agile at all levels, and that was sort of fairness to the complexity of the product. So there was three levels, or actually four levels. B0 is the commitment level. B1 is sort of a reaffirmation level. So they had to do a lot of estimates and re-estimates to lock down, the cost. And the cost was more than $300 million. That is the sort of range that we're looking for around 2-year project for 5,000 people. So they couldn't really, sort of swing it and figure out later on that nothing worked. So they did all the things correctly. So they went through sort of an SDLC model, which is not what I recommend, but that's what they did. And then they went in the agile way, so that they would do XP or Scrum or Kanban or all kinds of stuff for really in a year and a half. During that time, a lot of their employees or coaches, internal coaches, would often talk at a lot of conferences worldwide about how cool their agile implementation is going and how they are sort of the best experts in the industry implementing agile. So following that phase where you see these circular places, they would do a system test which lasted around 6 to 8 months. Because of the complexity of the hardware involved, the system test was possible only in China. And once that is done, the product was supposed to ship in 2 years. As reality goes, the more bigger the product gets, it gets really tough to do agile at all phases because of the cost and because of the complexity factor. So most organizations tend to use it in a very small sector. I mean, maybe a subset, but very few telecom companies go all the way using sort of some sort of an agile implementation. So this is the second point I want to talk about. The third point that's also worth looking at is a skill barrier. So when we talk of a telecom stack, we are talking about, I'm just showing you a few languages. Actually, there are 7 languages involved in this product. I'm showing you at a higher stack level, the topmost level was C++ and Java. Going further down at the TCP level, at the in-between layer was using C. And at the hardware level, we were using embedded C. And some around 4 more languages that would support this product end-to-end. So if you take around 5,000 people and split into Scrum teams, and on average, let's assume there are 150 teams, 100 to 150 teams. So the first challenge that came across as we started implementing this product worldwide was, how do you form teams with people who are such specialists in the kind of work they do? And typically in an organization, large organization like this, there are various levels of employees. So we would have architects, we would have senior leads, we have experts in communication protocol who only knew C, C++ experts, signaling experts who are only working at the sort of a controller level, a low-level level where they would do embedded C. When you form a Scrum team, there is one of the saying is we need to form a cross-functional team and not we don't want it a component team. More of a feature team. But when we take a scale of a product like this and sync up all the teams together, it was really impossible for teams to go about and form cross-functional teams. So they ended up with various kinds of UI team, a C++ team, and C team, an embedded C team. They tried to go for around 20 to 30% of these large group with around 30 teams to go cross-functional. So in those teams, what was done in the first year as this project went along was something called a skill and secondary skill. So every team had to have more than one person, and that one person, every person had to know more than one language. So suppose I knew C, and then I need to learn, maybe I can learn Java. Suppose I know C++, maybe I can learn embedded C. If I'm a developer, then I could learn testing. If I'm a tester, at least I could learn how to write a unit test in C. Some of the challenges that came along is a tool set. So when we look at a stack like Java or C++, you can do a lot of things like C, TDD, test-driven development. Very easy to do at something as easy as Java or C++. As you start going at the C level, or more so at the embedded C level, things like acceptance test-driven development, or even test-driven development, or even simplest things like writing automated unit tests becomes a challenge for the teams. So that was one of the challenges these teams faced, is just a fairly complex task of building a very large product. So they ended up just doing what they could do best. You know, they would do their own particular languages and test where they can and go further. And this was a challenge that we faced pretty much all the 2 years of working there. The other large-scale problem that we had was what is generally known as backlog filtering. You know, when you take a small product, yes, Scrum does work. And we can think about Scrum has one product owner, and it was really meant for one team and one product owner. However, when you take a product as big as this, there were what we call as product owner groups. On an average, there would be around 30 product owner groups. Their job is to take a huge backlog and filter them into multiple smaller backlogs. So if you take a huge roadmap, think of mini roadmaps that come from there, and all these roadmaps have to report back into a large group in Europe, so that we can that they could see the entire product in progress. So all of this had gotten really well. In fact, they used an awesome online tool. They had all kinds of video going on. They had all kinds of Scrum of Scrums, Meta Scrums. I mean, you can think of it. They had every possible way of. They had agile coaches by the day. They had technical coaching, they had Scrum coaches. I mean, it was just an awesome place to be. And as you think about this, and they had synchronized sprints, they had, Uber product owner, chief Scrum master. You think of a chief product owner. I mean, anything and everything that you would wish in a large-scale Scrum and Agile implementation was going on here. But they forgot to do just one little thing. And then today it's basically what we call as, they now call it as back to basics. They're going to go back and stop doing agile, and they need to go back to a pre-agile state, partly because they failed to do one little thing. And if I want to take a minute and think about what I wanted to think about, what is that they could have failed? You know, why would a large implementation of $300 million after such a long journey of a struggle of agile implementation with so many cool aspects fail? So I don't know if you can answer me. Let's see, possibly. But if you can text Antara and give me an answer on why would this have failed, maybe Antara can shoot it towards me. So I'm going to wait for a second and see if anyone can answer why it could have failed. Antara, can you turn on speakers, please, for a minute?
Yes. Yes, okay,
So anyone can guess why it failed?
We have one answer saying lack of coordination between the product owners.
That's awesome, but that's not the right answer. Let's pick any one person, any one more person.
There's another saying management overhead, too much of load slowed down teams.
That actually happened. A lot of command and control agile happened, but that's not true either. So I'm going to continue. Right? I am going to continue saying this, but what happened, you can put back on mute and if you want. So what actually happened was they forgot the customer. So they never shipped this product to production. And just before like a month and a half, when they actually went through the system testing phase that I showed you out here, and then they realized that the competitor shipped a product which was just maybe 10 times as cheaper as this one. And there was a brand new protocol change that had happened in the law. In European law, that they had not taken into account. So when that law change happened, they had to go back all the way to the B0 phase in order to accommodate that one small change, because they had not really planned for an automatic change. So basically, they forgot to even ship it to the customer. So the lesson learned here for me was, they called off the entire project. All the 5,000 people are not doing something very cool, but not this particular project. So as an industry, there is a whole saying that 50% or 65% of software we produce is never used. And when you think about, you know, we are made to feel that Agile is the golden bullet. But if you really step back and start thinking about what Agile is all about, if we miss the whole concept called going to production or showing it to the customer as fast as possible, anything and everything that we do cannot be successful. And so this project was basically a throwaway now, and it's now, you know, all the lessons learned are really good in writing in books, but more than that, nothing much. So they're now going back to basics, which means they haven't really learned why it failed. They just have gone back to going back to waterfall for the next year. So setting one more failure on top of another failure. So I just want to present a few thoughts for those people who are new. 1 second only, right? So the Scrum framework, you know, the concept of three roles and how important it is to keep focus on these three roles. In this project, the problem we had was the product owner was actually one of the managers. Architects were the Scrum Masters, and delivery team had got teams like, you know, dev team, QA team, things like that. They couldn't really figure out how to create cross-functional teams. If they go back and think about what, and the Scrum Masters also reported worldwide to all product owners. So if you look at one flaw in the structure itself, when you set up Scrum, it needs to be loosely coupled, and the basics of Scrum, of Scrum Master being just a facilitator and enabler, needs to be followed. So when something as big as this happened, there was a lot of pressure. The product owner would put pressure on the Scrum Master to ship something. The Scrum Master would put pressure on the delivery teams to ship something. And essentially nothing worked because of a lot of these practices that look cool, but nobody knew why they are doing these practices. Then Scrum has these four ceremonies, these ceremonies would run more like stressful meetings all over the world, because they were in panic mode all 2 years of getting something done. So there was a lot of focus on getting things done fast. And so there was no focus in the end on like why we are doing. So basically doing the ceremonies without knowing how to do them well was one of the problems that they had. All these tools are product backlogs and sprint backlogs. You know, there is a saying in Agile that beautiful sticky notes do not translate to awesome code. You can have all the cool sticky notes and all the cool code and all the cool tools you want, but if you don't write good code or if you don't take care of the engineering practices, it doesn't work. So a case in point here is that compile and build time would take 2 days. It was not possible for them to even make a change in a day, because every time a change is checked into the integration build, you could have waited 2 damn days to get this thing working. So a lot of the organizations do the semantics of doing Agile. They do the mechanics of doing it. They just don't do, you know, they don't go back to the basics of focusing on the engineering. There's a lot of focus on Agile and Scrum and all the coolness of sticky notes. But people forget that the base of software is just cool engineering and doing the simplest possible thing that can work in terms of architecture. Then Scrum has something called 5 levels of planning. So it's important to plan at all these levels. In my view, the most important plan is the daily plan or the team planning, and this was missed. And so once teams stop doing daily Scrum, anything you do, nothing can be done, right? So I think the biggest thing is to not focus on, the whole the complexity of planning and road mapping and all of that, but focus a lot on your simplest possible stuff, daily planning or daily Scrum, and let teams really bring up their impediments and then challenge them to get things done. So don't bottleneck them. I think the biggest problems we see is managers tend to bottleneck all the teams. They put all kinds of pressure. So my recommendation to managers is get out of the way and let the teams conquer the world. Most of the times, you know, when you talk about a scale program, you're often shown something as complex as this, you know, product visioning, product road mapping, release planning, iteration planning, daily planning. And if you don't do, you know, simple things, then things don't scale out. And I'm just going to keep the story going, and I'm going to skip some of these things. So getting back to the core, you know, why we do Agile, you know, many people forget that Agile is a mindset. We are not here to do, you know, complex things. If we have to do more and more complex things, we need to enable organizations where people can think and do not have to act like slaves of agility or slaves of managers. They need to feel empowered to do whatever they need to do to get their job done. On a high level, when we talk about Agile, we talk about ROI, we talk about focus on quality, and we talk about, you know, the fact that it reduces risk and reduces waste. So the point here I want to stop on is reduce waste. If you cannot have an organization where waste cannot be removed, for example, one of the ways in this particular project was a lot of team meetings. There were so many levels of hierarchy that every hierarchy wanted to know from the next level of hierarchy what's happening with the project. So literally they would spend like 30% of their week focusing on metrics and results, and because people had no time to code, coding as an activity would happen in the groups that at least I saw for only for 3 to 4 hours in a day, or worst case maybe when you get back home is when you really got to code. So I think, you know, as we start implementing Agile, we really, I know we want to do the right things, but then the system doesn't allow us to do it, and then we start blaming it on other people. So working on simplest things and focusing on quality from the team is really important for the success of agility. So want of time, I want to just sort of think about what is the value prop Agile, what is the value prop Agile brings to the table? And if we really think big, right, visibility, adaptability, business value, and reduction in risk. And if and when we talk about, in this case, right, that they did not ship it to the customer. Therefore, the risk of change was too huge, and they just forgot about it. And this is my problem. If I had a similar project in 2006, a huge product that never got shipped to the customer, and that also failed. So over the 7 years of Agile being there, I don't think the thought leaders are seeing it enough that be close to the customer and show him or her what they want and ship off onto production. That's the only way to be Agile. Anything else only sounds cool, good, and looks cool, and then it only ends in some sort of failure. So so I want to end with just a small section on the why. Right? So when we talk about the why, there is a model called the Simon Sinek Golden Circle model. And what it talks about is thinking about, you know, either you can do outside in more conventional way of agility. Somebody on the top says everybody needs to do Agile, and we drop dead and everybody does Agile. How about creating an organization where people understand inside out why, right? So why are we doing Agile, and enable an organization to ship to the customer, connect the customers, make them closer to the teams such that people really know why they do Agile. Most of the teams in the world do not know why they are doing Agile. They are only told how to do it and what to do in that particular implementation. So I'm going to sort of end with some of these thoughts, right? So focus on values, focus then on principles, focus then on practices. Only if you go in this way, you get the benefits. If you do the other way, like in this particular product, they completely forgot about the culture, they forgot about the values, people only did the how and what. Nothing comes out of such implementation. Essentially, in some sort of way, it's a failure. And something not to forget is 60% of Agile implementations in the world succeed. Similarly, 35% of waterfall as well as Agile projects fail. So really, the same correlation between any other process in Agile is if we don't focus on the values and then do less of the principles, core practices, then only we can get to the benefits. Okay. So I'm going to skip some of these. I think I've already done some recommendations. Focus on the mindset, you know, focus on best of class reliable systems, engineering practices that keeps us focused on quality, short loops where we can shift to production really fast. You may want to look at a YouTube video on Nordstrom Innovation Center and see how quickly they can ship. They go to the store and the developers code in the store to ship software, and that's the level of agility that organizations are getting to. Okay, so I would sort of, you know, leave at with that note. That any, you know, when you let's say you want to learn more about something like this, you're welcome to visit our website, and on the reference section you will see a lot of white papers, and you're welcome to connect with any of our coaches who can give more sort of, we are practitioners and not theorists, and we want to tell you more about why this can fail rather than why this can succeed. So feel free to connect with people, connect with me as you go along this journey to learn more about Agile. So I want to sort of end with, you know, a small note. Anyone can press the keys, right? So people can say, do Agile, you know, do this, do that, top management goes to a class, and you know that we can do all of that. But in order to play music, it requires a lot more of of practice. And like this guy, you know, John Smith, who can play reverse, we want to have enabled teams. You know, teams need to know what they're doing. What I'm really sad to see is in most of the world, the teams are not told what they're doing. They don't even know how much money that they're making for the company. They're just completely kept in the blind spot. So my request to the managers and management of the world is get out of the way of the teams, hire the best people, and tell them how they can be close to the customer in order to ship and not fail large-scale implementations. So with that, you know, I want to end this session, and I want to leave it open to any questions. And I want to thank you for taking the time on this mini-series, and I look forward to the next webinar series that comes, I think, really next month. And I think Antara will tell you a lot more about that. Thanks all. My email ID is Vibhu at solutions.